Lacrosse Legends. Lacrosse Legends, a comprehensive look at America's greatest game, featuring legends past, present, and future.
Today on Lacrosse Legends, we chat with lacrosse legend Paul Gait.
There's a whole list of people that you join, but, I got to be honest, there's so many players, you know, so many All-Americans, so many Hall of Famers, it'd be difficult, but for me, it's an easy one because, you know, for me, they honored myself, but I look back at my time in Syracuse, and it was really the Gait brothers, and, you know, we wouldn't have had the success we had, and I wouldn't have had the accolades I had unless, you know, my brother was there. You know, and I really thought that, you know, it was a nice honor. I would love to see his jersey go up beside mine. That's the way we're here as student athletes. We worked together as a team, we were the Gait brothers, and we made each other better through the work of, the teamwork between brothers, and along with the rest of the team, we were able to compete at the highest level. And I really think I owe everything to my brother Paul, and I'd love to see what they're.
Mr. Paul Gait, President, Gait Lacrosse. Gait Lacrosse, synonymous with innovations, new ideas, and new products. Lacrosse Legends visited Mr. Gait at the Gait Lacrosse Headquarters in Central New York.
How you been?
How have I been? I've been good. Coming off vacation was very nice, but getting back to work, I'm a little overloaded. So, but I'm happy to be at work. You know, I love what I do, and it's a great job. And when you're a lacrosse player and you get to work in lacrosse every day, it's a blessing for that person. And I'm happy to have that happen every day.
Yes, sir. Rodney Dumpson sends his regards.
Hello, Dump.
I was telling him how amazed I was with the innovations that you have here, and he schooled me. He said, nah, he was coming up with innovations way before Gait Lacrosse. He was telling me back at Syracuse how you had the curved stick. So I asked him, okay, the head of the stick is at 9 o'clock, bottom of the stick is at 3 o'clock. Where was it on his stick? He goes, 9 and 3:30. Like, wow.
Wow.
So I could see, like, ooh,
the bent handle is the predecessor to the offset head. It actually does the exact same thing that an offset lacrosse head does. So really, you know, it lowers the center of gravity of the ball in relationship to where you hold the stick, which is exactly what an offset lacrosse head does. It also lowers the scoop or the release point of the ball, which is exactly what an offset lacrosse head does. So really it was just the predecessor to the modern lacrosse stick.
And he told me also about the hidden ball tree. How could you forget about that one? But I could see where there could be a problem with it.
Now you're talking about like everything that was outlawed.
Yeah.
You know, you start talking about all this great innovation and you're talking about everything being outlawed, which is quite honestly something that's been happening my entire career, and it still happens today.
Yeah.
Bailing on right now on a revolutionary new D stick to kind of level the playing field for stick checks, and the rules committees are afraid of it. They don't know anything about it, so they just decided to outlaw it without even understanding it first.
From an outsider looking in, it looks as if they moved the goalpost on you almost with the Gait D, the defensive stick.
Yeah.
Is it like it was the edges were too sharp or something like that?
No, well, originally I'd made it so it would have a huge impact. So I made the hooks on this stick or the angles on the stick under 90 degrees so that when you grab something, you could literally pull hard on it. And it would, for instance, pull the stick out of a player's hand. So it really exemplified what I was going for. And I knew quite well that that would never be allowed. But at the time, it was well within the rules. So I was kind of making a point, like, you're letting this happen. Let's work together and make one that's legal, that helps kids check the ball out of the sticks, but also is safe for the game. And that was my intention. That was my goal. It was also to create some extra marketing, because obviously I knew there would be a rule change around that. I was hoping they'd make a rule change and allow us to continue with that feature, but at a much safer angle.
Sounds like it was very frustrating that you could go, go through all that, and at the last second, back to the drawing board. It's like, wow, that's
well, they've been, the rules committee, and one particular person who's been on the rules committee for the last 35 years, has been outlawing or changing rules for everything that I've applied for with the rules committee, or that I used in a game where there was no rule for. They added rules or they changed rules so to make stuff illegal. You had mentioned the curved handle and the predecessor to the offset stick. Well, in 1991, my senior year, the only team that was using the bent handle was Syracuse University, and there was a man on the rules committee that decided that needed to be outlawed. No justification, no understanding of it. They just said, we need, Syracuse has won, you know, two championships in a row. The team's on pace to win the third. We need to outlaw the stick. Gotta be the stick, right? Gotta be. But of course, without understanding it, you'd think they'd have a reason, but no reason, they just outlawed it. So here I've been playing my whole career with this bent handle or offset stick, and the rules committee decided to outlaw my senior year. That's a tough one, because you get used to an offset stick, and then all of a sudden you go back to a straight stick and it changes things. So now you gotta kind of relearn how to throw, shoot, that sort of thing. That was one, and then you talk about the hidden ball trick and stuff like this. In 1990, they made a rule against the way the ball is inbounded after it goes out of bounds. You know, they used to allow two or more players to stand together. And Gary and I used to always stand together and pretend one had it and the other didn't. Well, of course, in 1990, they outlawed that again after two championships. And then, you know, we've all heard about the air gate.
Yes.
Which was a move that was designed to catch one particular team off guard, and it worked. We got lucky and they won us a championship after a lot of hard work creating this move. And then a few years later, again, the rules committee decides to outlaw it. So, you know, it just goes on and on and on with the rules committee.
Something's up. I don't know what it is.
I'm with you.
I don't know what it is. Air Gate, how you came up with that? He told me that you were practicing with the basketball team in the same facility, and you said, "Hey, why don't we?" It's like you and your brother came up with that at the same time.
Actually spent quite a bit of time. So the way that came up was, we had played the University of Penn in a very close game, which we were losing most of the game, and we came back and tied, and we ended up winning, luckily. But they had this very effective zone defense that was very difficult for us to penetrate. And they also had a very good goalie who was hard to score from the outside on. So Gary and I decided that we're probably gonna end up meeting this team in the playoffs. So from the day that we had that game, the next week, we would practice in Manly Fieldhouse along with the basketball team, went off to the side, of course. We don't want to interfere, have a ball roll on the court and break a basketball player's ankle. So we would practice and we strategized for about a week trying to figure out how to score on this team that plays this zone defense out front. Basically, it was a six-man defense in front of the net, nobody behind. So we decided there's got to be a way to score from behind the net. So we spent the better part of a week or two figuring out 10 different ways to score from behind the net. Is it two guys behind? Is it one guy behind? You know, can you get to the face of the goal by passing and crying, you know, having the defense be on one side, then the other? And ultimately, we ended up coming up with this air gate dunk. And it was something that we both, I don't know which one of us came up with it. Quite honestly, it could have been me, even though Gary's the one who's famous for it. But the fact it was a culmination of our discussions back and forth. So similar to what we do today and what we've done our entire playing career, is discussing, you know, will this work? Discussing what's in the rules, what's allowed and what's not allowed, and how do we play within, in between the lines of the rules. Find rules that they haven't written yet and figure out ways to use that to our advantage. So that's how the air gate came about, was a stretch. And quite honestly, it worked perfectly because we developed it at Manly Fieldhouse, and then we brought it into practice and we used it, and we got some field time to practice it long before we broke it out in the game. So then we didn't want to break it out prior to the Penn game. So really it was the first time that anyone saw it, you know, in game action. Meanwhile, our teammates were well aware of it, because, you know, anything that you want to perform in a game, we always felt you had to perfect in practice. So everything that was unique to people that went to a game was not unique to our teammates, because we always made sure we did it during practice. So we were well rehearsed.
Next on Lacrosse Legends. You're watching Lacrosse Legends.
Physics background?
No physics, no engineering. I mean, I'm untrained in engineering and design. I do a lot of that, obviously, every day. You know, we design tools, lacrosse heads, protective. And when you're trying to be creative and unique, it involves a lot of engineering and a lot of design work as well.
How do you come up with these ideas? Because you're constantly improving. I think a few years back, I saw a demonstration for the girls, the gait draw. And it was perfect. It was like you turn it, you flip it, it's got the sides.
Again, it's reverse engineering for Gary and I. We look at the rules. So we looked at the rule book and we said, well, it doesn't say how wide a sidewall can be. You know, it doesn't say it can be a quarter inch wide or 2 inches wide. It just gives dimensions for the inside of the stick. So we figured out a way to make the sidewall a double sidewall with an air gap in between, which allowed the sidewall on the draw stick where the ball sits to be super narrow.
Right.
So therefore, when you turned it on the side, instead of it rolling down to the plastic, it was already where the ball sits. So it was a huge advantage, and still is today. Still, every stick every team in the country still uses that stick for their draws now. Oh, so
okay.
That was a winner, home run, and that was the flagship for our relaunch of our women's business as well.
It's also on a safety tip. I don't know if you planned this, but I film highlight reels. I've been in the girls' game, and I've seen a girl go for a ground ball, and her head goes down, and the goggles go, and she had a gash on her nose. With your stick, there's not as much bending. It's like you could literally come in, pick it up, because the way the curve is at the end.
Yeah, the front angle of the stick is actually designed to be in perfect alignment for a girl in a standing position, or slightly bent, the athletic position as we call it, to pick up the ball without having to get the backhand down. And a lot of the girls are now picking up the ball with one hand because they're getting stronger. Mm-hmm. So again, it's that height where it's, you're kind of in your athletic position. You put the stick straight down and the scoop is on a matching angle. So therefore it makes it easier to pick up the ball. So yes, you are correct. That was part of the plan as well.
Oh, good. I hope they noticed that.
Well, no, not a lot of people know that, but we wanted to make sure. Yeah. The number one thing that happens on a draw is, one, you want to try and win it in the direction you want it to go, but the ball is always on the ground. Like, it doesn't always go to you. So you can, and the good girls can do that, but 90% of the time the ball's on the ground. So we wanted to make a stick that was perfect for picking up ground balls, or better than anyone else's at least. So that's how that happened. It was all part of the strategy and the design.
Overview of the process, your idea to ending up on the shelves.
Well, okay, let's talk about you want a stick to shoot harder.
Okay.
So you look at the factors that, you know, what makes a girl shoot harder? One's her strength, right? Two, the strength needs a wind up. The stronger you are, the longer your wind up can be. The stronger your wrist motion is. So you look at, add those three things, and now you can have a stick that allows, that needs to hold the ball for a longer wind up. So therefore, it's how you make a stick that now can hold it. If a girl's going to wind up like a guy, and the back of her stick can hit her ankle before she shoots. In the old days, it would be at a 45-degree angle and it'd push, so they wouldn't need a lot of hold or a stick that would hold the ball in a certain position. So basically what happened, we just said, all right, the ball needs to be held. It needs to be held closer to the end of the stick. We'll angle the sidewall, we'll shift the pocket, and then you reverse engineer that. You say, well, okay, well, how do we do that? Well, you shift the stringing holes, you change the angle of the bottom, you change the angle of the top, change the angle of the transition up to the scoop. But the important thing is, how much travel do you need coming out of the scoop? So therefore, that's the most important part, because the bigger the windup, if the scoop has too much travel, it'll throw down. So you need to bring it down to it just right. So, you know, all these trial and error kind of things that get involved. You know, obviously we have a lot of the sticks to base stuff on, so we know what stick one does, we know what stick five does. So both of those are not enough. So we know we need to go past five. So now we're creating a new territory. So maybe we raise it half a quarter inch, half an inch from the sharpest one.
Well, hence you have the torque one, the torque two, the air one, the air two, the ground.
Well, and at this point with Gait, at least on the women's side and the men's side, we don't like making the same stick over and over. We find in the men's games, that's what happens, right? Everyone makes a stick, they all look the same. Women's stick, nobody knows really what they're doing, but they all kind of look the same. Every one of our sticks has a different performance feature and a different purpose for the player. Mm-hmm. So we have five women's sticks right now, and they all are for different players, either because they play a different position or they have a different throwing style.
Wow.
So, you know, I can go out and pick one of the five, and depending on your style, one is going to suit you better than the other four.
How long does this process take from beginning to end?
It's 6 months.
6 months?
It's 6 months.
So, right.
Pending legality and rules committees. I mean, I'm working on the next great men's and women's D-sticks for the future. And that's been a bit of a challenge. I mean, we're a year into it now. I had it ready to go in 3 months, actually. It was like a record pace because I wanted to launch this thing early and quick. So I had, from concept to development to getting it on field, was 3 months.
Next on Lacrosse Legends. You're watching Lacrosse Legends.
And Paul gets a little opening and scores! Paul Gait! 360. He keeps the ball. Now Gary starts to go to his left like he's cradling, like he's got the ball. Now the goalie, Brown, has got to move when he sees that man cradling and going to his left. Now Paul continues to walk like he does not have the ball. Now you see there's the cut. Now Gary's on the right, moving like he's got the ball. Watch Paul. Right there, you see the ball. As Brown moves over to play Gary, Paul puts it right on the left side of the net.
Relaunched Gait 3 years ago with a unique and different strategy that I've had with some of the businesses I've run in the past. In the past, most lacrosse companies are be-all, end-all when it comes to products for kids, you know. They would develop a lacrosse stick, you know, for an entry-level player, say at $29 retail. But then they'd have one at $69 as well. Then they'd have one at $99. Then they'd have one, their best one, at call it $199 or $200. Yeah, the difference between the sticks were so minimal that any player could replay with any one of them. And I proved that in the first outdoor national championship. I used the $29 stick when I played in that year. Just to prove that it doesn't really, the difference between a $29 stick and a $200 stick is nothing. They're all very much the same or very similar. So when I started this company 3 years ago, I said, you know what? I am no longer producing sticks that are so close that you can play with any one of them at different price points. I'm just going to make the best sticks. And I'm just going to price everything the same at the highest price point because I think our sticks offer more than any other stick on the market, so therefore it's worth more and it should be at the highest price point. So when you go and look at a Gait product, typically if you're looking at, say, a women's stick, you're not looking at different price points like our competitors have. You're looking at different performance attributes all at the same price level. I mean, it's a little pricey, but I think it's worth it, and it's proven itself now that the girls are certainly willing to pay it. And I couldn't tell you how many emails and letters we get telling us that since they've gotten our stick, their game has gotten so much better. So it's happy to hear. So they're willing to pay a lot more for our product, which is great. So we are considered a premium brand now, you know, yes, a top performance brand. And that was all part of our strategy when we launched the company. We said, hey, look, no more focusing on entry level. Because when I ran Under Armour, started Under Armour and ran Under Armour lacrosse, I had every women's stick from 29 to 250. And in between, and I had every color, I had every pocket style, I had all this stuff going on. And that takes up a lot of energy and a lot of time. I had multiple designers and engineers helping me along the way. At the same time, all it did by selling such a wide range of product, every time you get closer to that $29 stick, all you're doing is reducing your gross margin percentage each time. So it really didn't make sense to me. That's what Under Armour wanted, that's what they got. But really all they did was drive down my gross margin overall. So from a business sense, it made no sense to focus on all that lower end stuff. But they wanted to service every person under the sun. You gotta have a price point, you gotta have a color for every kid in the world. Yeah. I'm like, great, thanks, that's a lot of work and it lowers my margin. So that was one of the underlying reasons that Gait Lacrosse is now a premium brand, is because it just, again, it just didn't make sense put all that effort in creating all that overhead cheaper product that drives down your margin. So when you talk about time and all the stuff I have to develop, what's great for me is now all I do is focus on innovative, best performing products. So yeah, I've eliminated 80% of the work that the company has to do, and we focus on the top 20% of the best products in the world. So it's so much easier for us, and we need so many fewer people to get the job done. I mean, I do a lot. Like I said, I can do a lot because I'm focusing. I always did focus on that high-end product, and I gave my designers and engineers kind of all the lower-end stuff because they weren't the creative minds when it came to innovation. They were more the creative minds when it came to look, feel, color, that sort of thing. And I just handed it down. I can thank Under Armour for my recent success for making me understand that a be-all, end-all company to everyone is not always great because it just drives down your margin. And quite honestly, it uses up all your resources on stuff that doesn't make you money. And I think they have now learned that. I don't know if you know much about Under Armour, but they are struggling.
Ooh, okay.
I didn't know all I'm going to say.
Okay, all right. Your advice to not necessarily the young kids, but let's say the young parents who are not really familiar with lacrosse.
Everyone always says, oh, just go and buy an inexpensive stick for your daughter when she first starts playing, or your son. And I don't believe in that because a good stick helps you learn to play. That's my next focus, is justifying the price point of premium stick for you super young kids. But what these sticks are gonna do is they're actually gonna be a teaching tool for kids to help them learn the game. So we're trying to work with the rules committees on allowing some rules that they've outlawed, but these rules actually help kids learn to play the game and learn to develop skills. So I want to bring that to the market to help these young kids so they can practice and get better when they first start playing. And right now, the way it is you buy a crappy stick, it doesn't help you learn to get better at all. In fact, it makes it harder to play because the lower priced sticks tend to have no pockets. They don't help you cradle, they don't help you catch, you know, help you pick up balls. What you really should have when you're a kid is a stick that teaches you how to do all that. So that's kind of what I'm working on now, is really what I'm saying to parents is don't always get the cheapest stuff. Get something that's going to help your kid play the game. Because if you want your kid to develop skills and play well, they're never going to do it with a stick that doesn't help.
I think I'm asking the right person this question. How do you see the game evolving in the next 20 years?
Well, right now, the way it's gone, it's become an offensive game, which is what people like to see, and I agree. I was an offensive player, and I've spent literally the better part of 30 years trying to make offensive product better. It's only been the last year that Gary and I have turned around folk and said, you know what? We need to start working on the defense. We've made it, everything's been one-sided for 30 years. Let's start focusing on the defense, start leveling up the game again, getting it closer to where he and I played. Because constantly I hear coaches complain about these kids check the opponent's stick and the ball never falls on anymore. And the only way to get the ball out of the stick is you're going to knock the stick out of the kid's hand, or you knock the kid down on the ground. So it's becoming much more physical. I see it, unless the rules committee jumps on board, I see it actually becoming a more physical game down the road, which is not what everyone wants. They want it to be less physical, less contact, so there's less injury. So I'm hoping it goes that way, hoping that, you know, the rules committees finally wake up and understand that the stuff that some of us companies are doing are trying to eliminate the injuries and make the game involve less contact, I guess, you know, less injuries.
Clientele is quite impressive. I see the teams that use the Gait products, the players that use the Gait products. So
keep doing what you're doing. So I'm impressed.
We're working on it. Like I said, we just launched a men's line of heads halfway through last season, with the defense being the cornerstone of the product line. And so now we're kind of reeling things back until we get that back in line, because our women's business is doing so well. We've got plenty to focus on. And I don't plan on introducing men's protective to the retail marketplace until we win in men's heads, because that's what we, we're offensive players, we're defense, whatever we are. But the stick is the most important part of the game. You can talk to any native kid and it's part of their heritage. They get a stick and then they treasure it forever for the rest of their life. And the stick is the game. So Gary and I want to win in sticks before we start focusing on protective, because we've done well in protective. We've always sold a lot of protective, but it's not the main stick. You can play the game with a piece of crappy equipment, but if you can play a game with a stick that makes you play better, that's going to help you. And that's where we want to be. There's two things that nobody knows that I was involved in. One is the modern lacrosse helmet, and the second is the modern women's uniform. Back in the day, when lacrosse helmets were big, square, sewn helmets, they had a top section that was sewn to a bottom section, and they were almost square looking, like an old school football helmet. Well, at that time, I was working with a company called Sport Helmet, and they were the ones making the lacrosse helmet that everyone wore, these big, square-looking football-like type old-school bucket helmet, exactly. Well, during that time, they wanted to get into whitewater rafting, so they brought in a whole bunch of prototypes of whitewater rafting helmets. And when I worked for them, I would take a helmet a week, and I would put a face mask on, and I would go out and play in the Canadian box lacrosse leagues with these whitewater rafting helmets on. Until, so I narrowed it down to the ones that I liked. And it turns out the ones that I liked came a lot, were very close to their whitewater rafting helmet that they built. Obviously, I said, you guys are nuts. You're missing it here. This is not a whitewater rafting helmet. This is the future of a lacrosse helmet. They said, all you gotta do is put a face mask on it, which I had already done. Once they had their prototypes out for the whitewater rafting helmet, I was already using it on the lacrosse field and in the lacrosse box. So I was obviously the first one to ever use a cascade or the modern helmet in lacrosse, and it was obviously my idea to take their whitewater rafting helmet and make it a lacrosse helmet. So I take credit for the modern lacrosse helmet, no problem. And I don't think there's anyone out there that can argue that I did all that and it was my idea, and that a whitewater rafting helmet's the right fit for the sport.
Right on.
And then I mentioned the modern women's uniform. That one was a little easier. I was working with Under Armour at the time. In conjunction, we developed the modern women's uniform. We had just picked up the University of Maryland and Syracuse University as teams that we sponsored. I was right at the time, I was with De Beer Lacrosse. And I was working with Kip Folks, who was the number two guy over at Under Armour. And together, him and I, and one of our ladies who works here, Jennifer Levy, the three of us got together and we created what is now considered your modern women's lacrosse uniform. That one was really a lot easier though, because really what that was based on tennis outfits. So at the time, they had these big, long, huge pleated skirts,
yes.
And a men's golf shirt. And that was their uniform. And we're like, that's not comfortable. That doesn't allow you to move. What look do we want? Well, we want sleek, we want flexible, we want breathable, we want sweat wicking, we want all that. So Kip brought the materials. We brought the idea of the tennis look and feel. And now when you look on the field, really all it is a version of a tennis outfit. So, and that happened when Syracuse, seven-time national champions, Maryland, put on this uniform, and now all of a sudden everyone's got to have it.
What's your opinion on women wearing helmets?
My opinion of women wearing helmets?
Helmets in the women's game, should it be?
No, I mean, then it's the men's game. Just play the men's game if that's what you want to play. They want their game to be traditional. They don't want the contact. Once you put helmets on, you're going to have contact. You know, your checks are going to get closer to the body, you're going to get closer to the head. And then they're going to want arm pads and shoulder pads because they keep getting hit in the shoulder. And they keep getting it hit in the arm. And you know what I mean? So it's going to end up turning into the men's game. So I'm a believer to stay where it's at. Protective eyewear absolutely is important, but it's a non-contact game when it comes to the head. It's out of bounds. You're not allowed to touch it, not allowed to hit it. The only thing that can hit it really is the ball, and they have rules against that as well. Yeah. You know, you're not allowed to stand between the shooter and the net. The rule, so to prevent you from getting hit in the head with the ball. So they've got all these rules to prevent you from getting injured without the helmets, without the padding and all that. So they're already doing their job on that end to keep it traditional.
Field lacrosse or box lacrosse?
Field or box. Field or box, to me, it's the same. It's lacrosse. No matter what kind of version of lacrosse I'm playing, it's lacrosse. It's the same. And obviously, at this point, I don't play anymore. But when I did, that's what it was. And Gary, I always treated it that way. And that's probably one of the advantages we had. Because every skill we learned in box lacrosse, we knew we could use in field lacrosse and vice versa. So you could bring things that people may not be used to seeing from box, you can bring it to field and vice versa, so you can catch people off guard.
Well, Mr. Thompson is right. Your face belongs on the Mount Rushmore of lacrosse.
Oh, whatever.
Yeah. Thank you for everything you've done for the game of lacrosse, for everything that you're doing for the game of lacrosse, and everything that you're going to do for the game of lacrosse. More power to you. This is great, and if you can show me to where the gift shop is, I'm going to get some Gait apparel for myself.
You know, again, apparel, it's taking out way too much energy. It takes away from the high-end products, but I'll get you a vest on the way out. I think we've got some of those laying around.
Thank you, sir.
All right, no problem.
This is Monsanto Muzak for Lacrosse Legends.